Hello everybody and welcome to part 3 of the build of SuperFly 2. In this episode we are going to install the cantilevered front suspension. So just for reference, we'll just push SuperFly 2 back and bust out SuperFly. This is what we are going to focus on here. We're going to install this. So since we now know how it is supposed to look, let's go ahead and turn that into that. And we're just going to go ahead and jump in on this. So this is what you will get with the cantilever set. Now the cantilever set is separate from the front end selection. So again, this is the 10 millimeter offset version. And this is then the cantilevered front end. You're going to see here from time to time these little white dots. This is a prototype version where I just kind of had them all stuck together with a little piece of plastic. The new version, there's a sprue that runs through all of the holes, so now you're not going to get that. So just a little note that that's not going to be visible. I'm going to focus on the right side of the vehicle for at least the recording portion, and then I'll do the left side by myself. So let's start with this piece here. This is the rearmost mount that goes over here. Let me pull off this Nerf bar. Nerf bar removed. We're going to look over here and see some distinct features. First off is this sharp edge here. And secondly is this crease right here. Okay, can you see that? So I want to focus on this and this. This piece here is placed and in this orientation here, if you can see it like this. So basically when it is installed, this wall here is perpendicular to the ground. So you can see it when it's down here. This wall is perfectly vertical in comparison to the ground around it. We are going to want the back edge of this to be lined up with this crease in the chassis right here. And this edge here will be parallel to this edge, but 1 millimeter up from it. So it will be right about here. Okay, if you can see that there. So we are simply going to line it up. And this is not an exact science. Since you have that shock, it's going to allow you to have a little bit of freedom. So just as long as it is even, okay? You don't want this to look all crooked like that or something. So I'm going to put it in right here. Again, there's about a millimeter between this face and this face. If you can see it like so. And again, this back face is right on this edge right here. So when I have it lined up right here, I am going to get the spudger out and just put a little dot in the chassis. If you've got a fine tip pen, that would work as well. And the reason I want to do that is so that I can put the drill bit right in there, put a screw in here, which will lock that whole thing in place. And I'll show you what I mean right now. So there's my little indentation. It's a little bit hard to see, but actually it's not too bad right there. There's two options now. I can drill a larger hole in the chassis here, use a machine screw with a nut to hold whatever component I'm putting in onto the chassis, or I can drill it out to a 2.5 millimeter opening and use a standard self-tapping screw here. Originally, my plan was to put a nut on the back side, so I just kind of mocked up SuperFly with self-tapping screws. That was nearly 4 years ago, and not one of the screws has stripped or fallen off. So I'm going to go ahead and just keep with what works here and do the same thing. Use self-tapping screws. So this is my 2.5 millimeter bit. I'm going to make this dot a little bit deeper here just because it's a... I want to make sure that I get some good bite, and that looks very, very good. Again, if there's any younger folks out there, this is a ridiculously dangerous tool. So please, if you have one, this is not a toy. All right, there is the hole. Get that screw. And I'm just gonna go ahead and just thread it right in there. Okay, so this could be snugged up a little bit more. You can see it's a little bit loose, but I don't want to put all of the load on this screw right now. So I'm just going to kind of align it to where this is flat. See that there? That's nice and parallel to the this edge right here. And you can see how flush everything sits. There's a little tiny gap over here at the back. But overall, it's nice and flat. And when you put it on the ground, you'll notice that this is perfectly vertical and perpendicular to the surrounding area. My plan here is to use the existing holes, this one here and this one here, and simply use them to locate the future two holes. So I'll plop that in there. Take your time with this. Okay, that has been drilled. I will now place another screw. Probably should be using those shorter Tamiya self-tapping screws, but they seem to be like hen's teeth for some reason. Okay, so that is in. Okay, there is this bracket here. I'm going to install the other one since I've got this fresh in my head. So I have good news. Once you've installed this bracket right here, it is downhill from here on out. Everything else is ridiculously easy in comparison to that. So since we have that, we're going to install the other bracket. What this does is it provides the pivot point for the cantilever. This piece here screws into the shock tower, and these two mounts here go into the chassis. Now this one's a little bit easier because a lot of it does kind of self-align. So you can see it goes just about like that. There's a little boss in here that fits into the shock tower right there. So what that means is we're going to screw this into the shock tower and let this hold itself to the chassis. Now for this, I will use a couple of these shorter 8mm self-tapping screws. So for this, we're also going to drill out this opening here to a 2.5mm with a 2.5mm bit. So be careful when you're drilling this because you want to make sure that the drill goes straight through that hole and doesn't wander at all. Now that that has been drilled, we can go ahead and take our screw that is already parked in there. So you do want to make sure that that you don't strip this out because you need to use this self-tapping screw up here as a nut in this area would come into contact with the cantilever arm. So please be careful with that. This has pretty much set the other two screw holes. Okay, so that's where they're going to go. What you do want to make sure is that this face here and the top of the chassis here are parallel, and these two are pretty darn parallel. So as before, drill here and simply drill in a wee hole. Just remember, just be careful that the drill doesn't wander because you are only holding in by that upper screw. So just take it slow. As before, we'll put in the screw and thread that in. There are double walls back here, so you've got this little region here. You should be okay poking through both sides of it because this is not a high stress area, so you can use a longer screw here and get double walls of grip. And the last hole is that guy right there. Our cantilever brace is installed. The next parts we'll look at are the cantilever arms. These are going to go right here and pivot like so to allow the suspension to work. The thing is, we may go in different paths here. I'm going to use a ball stud here, and here I'm going to use a screw straight through this with a nut on the backside. And there's going to be a brass sleeve here that the shock absorber will ride on. It's possible that the shock that you purchase may have different geometry. This is what I'm working with. We'll talk about shock absorbers shortly. In the meantime, I'm simply going to drill this out to a 2.5mm since I want to bite into this with the machine thread. And up here, I'm going to drill that out to a 3mm since I want the thread to pass straight through this. And these are symmetric, so it doesn't really matter what way you put them in. All right, well, the holes have been drilled out the way I like them. It's pretty important to note that the holes, when you receive these, are something in the realm of 1.7 to 2 millimeters, so it's impossible to use them by just threading something in. I'm going to use these ball studs for the lower end of this cantilever arm. And on this side here, I'm going to have it so it points outward, like so. This is a standard Tamiya ball end, or ball stud. It's a M3 thread, and I believe the shank is 4mm. Do not over-torque these, because these teeth are very, very small, and although strong, you don't want to overstress them. So that one is done. And on the other side, we'll put in the reverse. So we want it sticking out the other direction here. You can see here that both cantilever arms are done, and now we're going to take these bearings here and install them on both sides. The information for these bearings is up on the screen right now, and it's really important that we do use these exact ones. They're very inexpensive, and will provide you with a very, very smooth suspension travel here. Before you seat the bearings, you do want to make sure that this area inside here is cleaned out. So I'm just going to take my X-Acto knife in here and just make sure that that little corner in there doesn't have any excess nylon powder, and that tends to happen in some of these inside sharp edges. Now, once you've got any excess nylon out of here, these things should go right in. Now, they do, just because of their sharp edges, they do tend to want to seat crooked, so just kind of, you know, be persistent with them. I wouldn't use a tool because a tool will force them in at an angle, so just use your thumb and eventually it will seat nice and flat like that. Now that our bearings are installed on both cantilever arms, we're going to focus on these little brass tubes. These are a very common Tamiya part. They're found in the rear suspension of the Hornet, but these here you're going to pull out of the front suspension of your stock Hornet. It's on the bottom eyelet for the front pogo stick, the spring. We're going to take these and put these in this hole here. So here's the deal. The combined thickness of both bearings should be about 5.85, okay? The total length of these is nearly 6, okay, so 5.97 millimeters. This means if these are not seated properly, when you try and push these through, they're not going to protrude, and they are going to not properly allow the bearing to float, okay? So I just push that straight through, and just so you know, it has never, ever been that easy to do. Usually it gets stuck, and that just kind of slid through. That's amazing. So that was kind of quick. We're going to push this one straight in here in the bearing. And what the heck? They both did it. Okay, apparently I'm getting good at this. This thing is going to pivot on that brass sleeve. The brass sleeve is going to be held in place or sandwiched between these washers here. For this, I definitely am going to use a machine screw to go through the cantilever arm into the central pivot hole here, and then a nut on the back side of it. So this is the M3 screw that we're going to use, and this guy is 20 millimeters long. This M3, we're going to take it, put a washer in. This is a metric washer, and the reason why it's actually important to use a metric washer so that it properly seats against that brass sleeve. So we'll put that in, then the cantilever arm, then another brass, and another washer. Like so. Then we shove it in here. Now, usually I talk about having to drill these out. And the reason I haven't done it here is any extra bite in these isn't a bad thing. Okay, so I really want this to be a super, super tight fit. So when this thing went in, it looked like it came into contact with the inside of the chassis here. So I'm going to pull this back off, and I'm just going to cut off about 2 millimeters of this screw using the Dremel. I probably don't have to. I think it just barely touches the tip, but I don't want to risk it. This is kind of a complex front suspension, and I want it done properly. To cut this off, if you are using a Dremel tool, in fact, you know what I might just use is a little mini pair of bolt cutters. I'm going to put a nut on, like so, and then we'll get the bolt cutters, mini little bolt cutters here. And I am just going to snip off, I don't know if you can see this, it's about 2 millimeters, okay? I'm going to do it aiming down so it doesn't go shooting. Because I have this nut here, I can now unscrew it, and it's stuck. We'll get our screwdriver there, Tamiya tool here, and that's it. Okay, basically it reforms the threads right there, and we're good to go. I have shortened that screw by 2 millimeters. So if you've got an M3 by 18 millimeters, awesome. Usually it's kind of a weird size. You're probably gonna have an M3 by 20. Okay, there we go. Let's, geez. All right, note to self, this has to be able to go in the other direction. So here we have it, a little bit, little tidbit from me, the designer who installed this incorrectly. You want this to rotate very freely, and it might take you a little snug and then a release to seat it all. So what should happen is it should be nice and tight in here. So the screw isn't moving. But this should move very, very freely back and forth because it's on a ball bearing. And that's what we want to see. We are on the home stretch, everybody. The last thing we have to do is install the shocks. Question I always get is, what shocks do you want to use? That is not an easy question to answer. The Hornet is a poor car to search for shocks because of its weight. This car is very, very light. If you put a standard 1/10 scale buggy shock absorber on this car, it's simply not going to work. The car doesn't weigh enough. These shock absorbers are from HSP. At least I think they're from HSP. If you search for HSP 1/16 scale shock absorber, you will come across these on eBay. They're very inexpensive. There's a few versions of them. These here are aluminum bodied with replaceable O-rings at the base. I've seen others that are all plastic bodied. In fact, I have a set on the front of my Frog and I really don't like them. The springs are too hard. You really want these very high density coils because they're very, very soft. And these are what you need for the Hornet. Again, you're welcome to purchase whatever you'd like for your application. For my experience, these have been the only things that come even close to the stock ones. Unfortunately, because they're for a 1/16 scale car, these eyelets are 2.5 millimeter and they're not going to work. So let's take them off. So I've got the eyelets off. Now these are 2.5 millimeter here at the end, and we need them to go through a 2.5 millimeter shock shaft, but a 3 millimeter screw. So fortunately, I've gone ahead and whipped up one of those here. I have a few versions of this depending on the length of shock. This shock is 85 millimeters and eye to eye it's about 78. So it'd be better if it was closer to 85 eye to eye, but it simply isn't. So I created these, which are a tad longer than the originals, and will then make up that lost length that we need. Because these are machine thread, it's really a pain in the butt to get them to start into these. We can try and see if these will play nice, and these actually might. Another option is to simply tap these. Use a 2.5 millimeter bottom tap. That means that the end of the tap is flat. It's designed to tap into closed holes. With the new eyelets installed, and just FYI, I did not tap these. They threaded in perfectly, so there we are. Remember those brass sleeves? You're gonna need more of them. These tend to be kind of rough to find from Tamiya, so it might just be better to get a 4 millimeter brass rod and just cut it up. The width of these is not nearly as important. Oh, what I wanted to mention too is that the cross section of this is not cylindrical inside here. It's actually two tapered walls because these are designed to go at the back of the Hornet using the Hornet lower suspension mount and actually pivot at an angle. So do not force these in there because they simply are designed to kind of wedge themselves in the middle. And so what we want to do is just take the X-Acto knife again, please be careful, and just clean these out, and that should just slide perfectly in there now. So same on both sides. You want to be careful because if you just shave off that little ridge on the inside, then you are going to have slop, and Tamiyas have enough slop to go around. You don't need any more. For these shocks, they also could use one of these little guys at the end to help reduce the amount of play. So let's install this. This is going to use a M3 with a nut on the back side of it. And this here is going to need a self-tapping screw. I'm going to start off by installing the back side of the shock absorber. So to do that, I'm going to take a self-tapping screw. This one here is 16 millimeters long. So the reason why I'm putting a washer here on the inside is that I want to make sure that the washer is what stops the screw from digging into the plastic and not simply have that sleeve cutting into it. Let's go ahead and thread this guy in here. For this hole here, you do not need to drill it. Just tap it straight in. And when it stops, remember, it stops. All right, cool, that is in. Next, we'll connect this up here. So for the connection from the shock absorber to the upper cantilever link, we're going to use a 16 millimeter M3, and it will go washer, sleeve, through the shock, and then another washer. And again, the reason for this is we want the washer to ride on the sleeve and not accidentally get compressed when you are snugging this up. And I am not going to use lock nut here because I want to keep as much space between the body and the suspension as I possibly can, simply because I just don't know if it's gonna fit. It did on the computer. We'll see if it does in real life. So I'll put this Tamiya tool there, snug this up again. You don't have to He-Man it. Just, there you go, it's in. The next phase is connecting the cantilever arm to the suspension arm. And my recommendation, if you want to keep your optional parts list down, is to use the lower part here that used to hold the front spring onto the shaft of the A-arm. So then you have this piece here, and you have the brass sleeve that came out of it. And I know I've been talking about all these different parts that we need. In the description, you're gonna find an entire parts list of recommended hardware for this kit. Again, you are welcome for some deviation on that, depending on what hardware you have available. In fact, I'm not gonna use these here because I prefer these ones here, these little shock eyelets that have the captured ball. I kind of like these a little more. The gap that you have inside of here is 6.5 millimeters. So if you go to a hobby shop, just again, your digital caliper is your best friend here. You can always just go ahead and take your digital caliper and measure this this gap right there. This isn't the only piece we need. We also need a ball end or a ball cup to capture the ball stud right here. And then to connect those two, we're gonna use a piece of 3 millimeter threaded rod. I recommend getting a all thread rod, which is about just about a foot long or so. They are solid threaded rod. Now this little bit that we're gonna do with this connecting rod here, this actually will determine your car's ride height. Now you can't get too extreme, of course, but you can kind of fluctuate about 10 or so millimeters. My recommendation is kind of what I've got on SuperFly, which is, it's around about 30 millimeters. So between 30 and 25 or so, you'll be pretty good to go. So I'm gonna start at around 30, and then if I want to trim it down, I can a little bit. I can't tell you how long the threaded rod is gonna be because that is, of course, dependent on how long your captured ball end and your ball cup is going to be. So I'm gonna go ahead and just install these and we'll be right back. These are my two linkages here, and just make sure that you do have them the same height. Let's go ahead and install these here. Once again, I'm using screw pins. Do wish I had that third hand. That would be awesome. All right, and that's gonna thread or push straight through there and out the backside. Again, these are a little bit longer, so I will trim them afterwards. And we'll pop this in right here. And I'll do the other side now. Both the right and the left cantilever connecting rods have been installed. And now you can see if we go ahead and put a load on the suspension arm, there is our suspension travel. And you can see here that the shock absorber is traveling nearly through its entire travel. If you did want a little bit more suspension height here, you could put a bit of a longer rod, or if you want to lower the car a bit, you could shorten that, and it does it very, very easily. And there we have it. You have probably noticed that we don't have a link that connects the upright to the chassis, so right now it's just flopping about. Usually you would have a center support here. This front suspension arm kit, so the arms, the uprights, come with these two pieces here. This is the more industrial support here, so you have to cut a little hole in the body. This point and this point attached to the grasshopper body post. And this is where you would install the ball stud. If you have a car whose body you don't want to cut, this version here also comes with the kit, sits right in there, and it will actually snake its way out under the body. So you can go from this point to this point, put your ball stud in there, and you're all set. This is less desirable as the geometry isn't as good as this one. And also this has a significantly weaker design, simply because it has to make this kind of weird little shape. So if you're gonna be driving the car more aggressively, you want to use this. And if you've got a little bit of a light runner, in fact, most of mine have this one here, and it works quite well. But again, this is very, very weak in comparison to this one here. Now, I'm not using either because I'm using this. There we go. So this roll cage has this member built in over here. If you look at the front, we're gonna use this here and this here. We're not going to install this just yet. This is gonna come a little bit later on. I have to paint it. This only comes in two colors, white and black, and neither are polished. The reason for this is size, so these don't get these can't be dyed. So if you do want a cage, and again, we'll talk about the cage more in depth later and variants that are available, but just so you know that that is what we're going to use on the front of this. With that said, we have completed the cantilever front suspension installation on SuperFly 2. I hope you enjoyed that. Again, we went through a quite extensive list of hardware that we needed. And if you look in the description, it will all be laid out right there. So again, that is what I recommend. You may have something better. You may hate these screw pins. You may hate these little ball ends over here. And so again, this is simply my recommendation. You are more than welcome to install and build any way you like, as this is why this hobby is so wonderful. Thank you so much for watching. Please stay tuned for part 4. And there's going to be some other episodes here and there in between. So I hope you enjoy them. Please subscribe. You'll be notified of my new videos instantly. And you can also find me on Facebook and Instagram at Ampro Engineering on both. And before you take off, please check out the band Blue Pinto. They allow me to play their lovely music in my channel. And a link to their Facebook page is in the description. Thank you so much, and let's just watch this one more time. That looks so cool. We will see you soon.